chop house in deep right center. That one.
That's a pretty good poke. He hits out of a fairly deep crouch. 1-1 the count.
Jarrett Wright pitched very well in Baltimore. Really didn't get much to show for it because of a mental miscue by Call and Jesse Garcia at the time up the middle. Wound up giving up 10 hits and 7 runs. 5 were earned, but he pitched a lot better than that.
1-2 the count. By the way, we mentioned Boston 8.5 games behind the Yankees. It's almost time for them to quit worrying about the Yankees. They're 2 games behind Oakland right now in the wild card race and only a game ahead of Minnesota, game and a half ahead of Anaheim.
That's pretty much what Manny Ramirez said a couple of days ago. He said, you know, it doesn't matter if we win the division or not. We just got to be in the playoffs. And he got criticized for that almost like a concession speech already. But I thought it was pretty wise on his part. And he's saying, hey, we just got to get in the tournament and then we'll worry about stuff.
And if you don't believe that, ask the Florida Marlins.
Yeah.
2-2 the count. That one rocked Johnny Estrada. 2 out, nobody aboard. Pittsburgh beat Milwaukee 8-1 in the first of 2 today. The Cubs were winners in their game over the White Sox. 6-2 the final there. And the 2-2 to Ortiz from Jarrett Wright. Pop foul back. Ortiz 4 out of 7 against Wright in his career. Kansas City today acquired outfielder Ruben Mateo from the Pirates in a cash deal.
Big news, of course, that news Mark Fine was talking about, Bob Brenly getting fired. I don't think that came as any surprise with the Diamondbacks just snapping an 11-game losing streak and really struggling.
They fired Chuck Niffen, the pitching coach, as well. Robin Yount resigned. Al Pedrique will manage the team the rest of the year, as Mark told you, fly ball foul.
That's interesting. That I wonder if Yount resigned in dispute of this or if he was actually offered the job to succeed Brindley and didn't want it. Very interesting situation.
Mark Davis is now the pitching coach. Tommy Jones will coach first. Dennis LaWallen is the bullpen coach. Glenn Sherlock will coach third. They're really shaking things up. Just missed. 3-2 the count. Red Sox made a deal. They got pitcher Brandon Puffer from San Diego for a player to be named later or cash. So a lot going on in baseball today. The 3-2 pitch. Where's that going to wind up? What a blast by Ortiz. It's 1-0. You mean you only get 1 run for that?
I think so.
That ball was crushed.
But you get coffee or tea or pretzels. A lot of Red Sox fans here, and I'm not sure that they're all Red Sox fans applauding that one. He hit a long drive in Yankee Stadium a couple of days ago that was way back in the right field bleachers. And if you didn't believe me about that batting practice home run, maybe this will convince you.
Well, it was down and in, but then it went down and out. Here's Ramirez. It's 1-0. Pretty good poke.
I'll say.
That's a strike, 0-1.
Just the 6th home run allowed by Jarrett Wright.
Manny Ramirez has been a pretty consistent player. In the last 6 years, he has had at least 30 homers and at least 100 RBIs every year. 1-1 the count. Nice feature on him in Sports Illustrated, the current issue, by the way. The 1-1 pitch. Strike 2 called outside corner.
One of the highest paid players in the game, and when the Red Sox were trying to make a deal to get Alex Rodriguez before the Yankees got him, Ramirez's name was the one that was mentioned the most as the guy going the other way.
Well, they ran him through waivers and got him through 2-2. Baltimore leads the Phillies 5-2. They're still in the first inning in Philadelphia. Another one of those games. The 2-2 pitch by Pop. That will reach the seats. Still 2-2. Toronto and Montreal are battling, two Canadian teams in Puerto Rico. Tonight, no score.
Manny's two home runs last night put him in a tie for first in the American League in homers. They've got a pretty good 1-2 punch in Ian Ortiz back to back.
Pop fouled out of play again, and when, and I say when, Garcia Parra gets going,
yeah,
they're going to score some runs. But I don't know if they're going to catch New York.
Well, that's a tough part for Nomar. He's been such a crowd favorite in Boston, and when he's trying to help the team out when he's less than 100% physically and still taking some heat, that's tough duty.
The 2-2. Strike three called at the knees. He knew it. The inning is over. A run on a prodigious home run. Bottom of the first, 1-0.
We go to the bottom of the first with the Red Sox on top by a run. Let's check out the Red Sox defense first of all. Jason Varitek, Bronson Arroyo form the battery tonight. Third to first, Bill Miller just off the disabled list with a sore knee. Then Nomar Garcia Parra, five-time All-Star, but missed the first 60 games of the year with an Achilles tendonitis that's still bothering him. Second baseman is Mark Bellhorn. Over at first base, David Ortiz. Their outfielders, Trot Nixon, Johnny Damon, and Manny Ramirez. Braves lineup tonight for Bobby Cox. Pretty much the same as it has been with one notable exception. Adam LaRoche returning to the lineup. He'll bat sixth tonight, play first base.
Rafael Furcal takes a pitch outside. One ball, no strikes. Bronson Arroyo, 6'5", 190-pounder. Out of Key West, Florida, lives now in Brooksville, Florida. The count evens, 1-1. High pop. That wouldn't be a home run in a phone booth. One out. Braves in Espanol, which is Spanish lingo for in Spanish, is brought to you by Office Depot. The announcer is Pete Manzano, Fernando Palacios.
Bronson Arroyo, a guy who has really struggled lately. His last six starts, he's 0-6 with a 5.79 ERA. But the Braves have seen him before, and he's pitched well against them while with the Pirates.
Nick Green takes a pitch outside. One ball, no strikes. Good breaking ball. That's the pitch he has to throw for strikes, they tell us. 1-1 the count.
Kind of a sweeping breaking ball. Works effectively as a changeup, too.
Yankees at Mets, delayed by rain. They're supposed to have horrible weather in New York this weekend. There's that breaking ball again. 1-2. Green waits. And the curveball again. Two out.
He was trying to connect on that breaking ball, this at bat, so why not keep throwing it to him? He's going to swing at it, and Arroyo put that one just a little bit off the plate where Nick couldn't reach it.
So two are out, and J.D. Drew, the batter, hitting .294. He has played before against Arroyo. Two out of seven against him. Takes outside. One ball, no strikes. When we go to the second inning, Dave Winfield will join us. If any fights break out up here, I want him on my side.
Well, you would need it.
Not in this booth, I wouldn't. The 2-0 pitch.
That's the international man of intrigue over here, you know.
2-1 the count.
JD's playing great baseball right now. Offensively, defensively, running the bases. He's doing it all.
Two balls, two strikes, fastball away. Great crowd on hand. It doesn't appear to be capacity, but very close. And a big fireworks display after the game. The 2-2 squib foul. The count stays the same.
Arroyo's been up and down between AAA and the big leagues the last 4 years with Boston. But last year at Pawtucket, he was the Boston Minor League Pitcher of the Year. He was the International League Pitcher of the Year, went 12-6 for Pawtucket, and 3.43 ERA.
Full count, 3-2. The Red Sox not only activated Bill Miller today, they placed right-hander Scott Williamson on the 15-day disabled list. He has a nerve impingement in his right forearm. Bounce foul again. And they recalled pitcher Anastasio Martinez from Pawtucket, designated infielder Cesar Crespo for assignment. So it's been a busy day for Boston. Struck him out and the inning is over. He foul tipped it, but he went around anyway. And Arroyo looked great in the first. Dave Winfield joins us in the second. Who do you think you are, Mr. Big Star? Who do you think you are, Mr. Big Star? Tell me.
We're in Kansas with a great Lynette.
Nomar Garciaparra leads off the second inning in a 1-0 Boston game. He is 7 for his last 38. And he hits the first pitch well into right center, but it's playable. Who wants it? Andrew puts it away. One out. Garciaparra retired. And we are glad to welcome an old friend, Dave Winfield, to our booth. Dave, good to have you with us.
Skip, good to be here, Joe. Good to see you.
Nice to see you again, David.
If you think we've forgiven you for 1992, you're wrong. Come on. We'll treat you well anyway.
Come on, guys. You got me back in 95 when I was with Cleveland.
That's true.
We're even.
Trot Nixon, the batter. Nixon has spent most of the year on the disabled list with a bad back. But he's back and playing now, hitting 275, three homers, six runs driven in. Boy, that Ortiz put a charge in one, didn't he, Dave?
He's a big, strong kid. He's coming to his own. Minnesota misses him, but he's very happy in Boston.
The 0-1 pitch. Outside to even the count. Did you consider at all being, when you were drafted by the Atlanta Hawks, playing pro basketball? I was doing their games then.
You were.
You and I would have been hooked up together.
I hear you. Well, a little over 30 years ago,
yeah.
I had the opportunity. NBA lured me, but I wanted to play baseball. And I lived out my boyhood dream. 22 years in the big league.
Kind of worked out, didn't it?
Yeah, it worked.
Oh,
I think,
man,
you made the right choice. Ground ball to second, Green to his left. Nixon is retired, two out. Jason Varitek, the batter. Varitek has been struggling 0 for his last 15, but he's still hitting 274. You were drafted by the Minnesota Vikings, the Hawks, the Padres, and an ABA team. I forget which one.
Utah Stars.
Yeah, that's pretty.
ABA.
That's not too shabby.
Yeah, it was a thrill, unexpected, but I appreciated it, and no one has done it since. And I don't think you'll really see that anymore. You know, people focus on one sport,
yeah,
at an early age. Parents do, coaches do, and the way I came up in baseball, they just don't do it anymore.
Base hit left center. Varitek ends an 0 for 15 skid. Bill Miller, the batter.
And I'll finish that thought. You used to be able to play at recreation centers, get free training, you know, free. You just play all the way up from Little League to American Legion, perhaps get drafted or get a scholarship and go from there. Now it's specific sport training at very early ages.
Pick one, yeah.
Yeah. You won't see many multi-sport athletes like that.
How did the football thing come about, though?
He said this big.
They just took a chance on you?
Well, when you're 6'6", about 235 at the time, and could run and had good hands, they said you'd be a good tight end. And I said, no, I'd rather keep my health and go play baseball.
Be able to walk when you're in your 40s.
Exactly.
High and outside, one ball, no strikes. We were talking before the game, we're not here to preach, but you're a big guy. But still, if you're 5'7", or 6'6", or somewhere in between, you can be a star baseball player. That's not true in football or basketball.
It's true. Baseball, you can be any size, and I think the best example I use, and I, in fact, I told some of the young Braves players.
Runner goes, Estrada's throw.
I was telling some of the young Braves players before the game, back to your left fielder and a young man named Wise, I said, you can be any size to play this game. I remember there were a couple of years in the National League, and Joe Morgan, who is no more than... Let's be generous with Joe. Joe Morgan was he was head and shoulders, if you will, above every player in the league for a couple of years. Here's a guy 5'8", 150, 60 pounds, better than everyone. So you can be any size, from Randy Johnson, 6'10", 6'11", down to 5'6", 5'7".
First base is open. They're pitching to Miller with a runner in scoring position here. Veritek stole his fifth base of the year in seven tries.
Not bad for the catcher.
And a base hit is the result. Drew's got a great arm. Here comes the throw. Good throw. He got in under the tag, and it's 2-0. Miller's at second. Bang, bang, play. I thought they had him. But no argument, I don't think.
Jason Veritek showing you some wheels for a catcher. Boy, did he get a good jump on the crack of the bat.
It was a good throw, and I think he got him. Let's watch this. I think he tagged him. Yeah.
I think he got him on the arm.
He did. The umpire was not in the position, quite in the right position, to call that play. He was tagged from behind as he slid. Watch this. Wow, that's a great shot at home plate. It doesn't quite show whether he was out or safe. Here you go.
Yeah, he got it.
He's out. But he's safe.
That's all that matters. And Bronson Arroyo pops one into left field. And the inning will come to a close. Pitching to the number 8 hitter does not work out for Atlanta. A run, 2 hits, 1 left, 2-0 Red Sox. In tonight's All Access, Bobby Deuce takes us to his home away from the diamond.
My name's Bobby Deuce, and I'm the bullpen coach for the Atlanta Braves. We're out here today in South Georgia, where I grew up. Always wanted a place out here on a lake. I come down here on the off days and spend my winters here. Physically get away from the game for a little bit. Typical day for me, we'll get up and sit up there on those director's chairs and maybe write a little bit, check out the wildlife. I hope we don't see any alligators down here. And then I go fishing for a while. That's where you step. Snake's got to have a place to go to. Go into town and enjoy life.
That's Bobby Deuce, a terrific human being, great guy. We go to the second inning. Chipper Jones leads it off.
We have another segment to that, too. Bobby is such a deep guy, too. There's a lot more to him than just being a baseball man.
Yeah, he's an author, and he'll talk about that a little later in the game. Chipper, 3 out of 8 in his career against Arroyo, takes high and away, and the bottom of the second is underway. Along with Joe Simpson, Skip Carey, Dave Winfield has joined us tonight on Friday Night Extra. And that ball has well hit the center. Damon has run out of room. It's 2-1. We needed to see a little of that.
Did you ever go through a season where nothing worked for you, where everything was everything got off to a slow start, like for Chipper this year with injuries and things that slowed you down?
Through a whole year, only my last year I had injuries, and it was my last season where I couldn't put anything together. But I was just looking at Chipper. The year that he's had so far is so unlike him, and from a distance. I would look at it from afar, and I know he misses Gary Sheffield.
Yeah. You bet. Yeah.
A significant player in the lineup in front of you or behind you. It makes a total difference.
Hey, baby.
And that's Chipper
on,
Jones
be
hitting two, maybe 15 now.
Yeah.
Almost at the All-Star break.
Right.
Chipper can hit. He's 100 RBI, 30 home run man.
1-1 pitch to Johnny Estrada about to be made. Red Sox lead it 2-1, and it's 1-2 to the Atlanta Captains.
But I can tell you this, what you learn by being in the big leagues long enough is that you take it day by day, at bat by bat, game by game, and you know you can crawl back up in there with not only respectable statistics, but help your team.
Little looper, caught by Bellhorn, one up.
The guys, the young people that haven't been around, they can get down on themselves, don't believe, they don't know how to dig themselves out. But the true veterans, the gritty veterans, they'll know if they need to take more practice, less practice, work on their technique, their fundamental. They understand internally in their heart and their head and through their technique what they're doing wrong. And he'll crawl out of it.
He was frustrated last night, hit the ball hard a couple of times, but right at people.
Oh, yeah. And you look at Darcy Parra on the other team, on Boston. He's been hurt all year, so it's very hard to come in a third of the way into the season and think that your timing and everything is going to be up to snuff. So yeah. He'll struggle a little bit, but he's another 300 hitter, and I dare say you'll see him at that mark near the end of the season.
Yeah.
I'll give you another one, Derek Jeter.
Yeah.
A month ago, they said, what's wrong with Derek Jeter?
Oh, they're burying him. Yeah.
Look at him now.
Adam LaRoche is back and in the batter's box. 1-2, the count to him with one out, nobody on, and a run in. And a high pop will reach the seats. 1-2, the count.
One of the walking wounded back active. Marcus Giles expected back after the All-Star break. Horacio Ramirez, the left-handed starting pitcher, back perhaps before the break, if not a little bit after.
Bobby said tonight that Marcus would be after the break, maybe not right after the break, but within a week or so, and that Horacio might be a little longer than that.
Oh, really?
I was surprised to hear that. The 2-2 bounce to first. Pitcher gets a late start. Now they flip it to him just in time. Arroyo was watching the game like us there for a moment. Fans, log into AtlantaBraves.com now to get in the game, answer polling questions, play Beat the Streak, and get updates on your fantasy teams. Arroyo just now getting back to the mound. He and Ortiz talk it over and probably say to one another, that wasn't real pretty, was it?
Boston's had some struggles this year with their defense. And, you know, I look at it. I read an article in USA Today, and they were just talking about in tennis, the people who have the most unforced errors usually lose a game. And it's so true in baseball. You give the team extra outs, you fumble the ball, you bobble it, your chances are you're going to open the door for the other team to get that victory. And I'll add one more thing to it, and many fans at home may not realize this, but you've seen the end of infield practice.
Yeah,
we were talking about
games.
That in Baltimore.
Yeah,
they don't take it anymore. I took it for 22 years.
Yeah, why is that?
there's no reason for it in my estimation.
I don't think so either.
The game has changed, and really, look at many teams. Most guys aren't good enough to hold down one position. There's a lot of guys who aren't.
Yeah.
And here they're at a new position on a different day in a new ballpark. Don't know the terrain. And what if it's a 1-0 game? It ends up 1-0 in the first inning. It's decided on a defensive miscue.
Yeah.
Maybe if you take infield practice, that doesn't happen.
Well,
you know something else about that, Dave? We were talking about how fun it is to watch. I think a lot of fans like to watch infield practice and see the skills of these guys when they're doing it.
Oh, they do. I do. I can't put my finger on it, but you just don't see it much. Don't see it anymore.
Everybody thinks they get enough work in during batting practice, taking ground balls, but it's not the same as when you're turning two or taking a couple of rounds or even throwing from the outfield. That's something that the outfielders don't do.
Well, that's what I look at a lot, and I'm sure you did too. But, you know, if I haven't taken infield practice, I was last on the field an hour, 15 minutes ago after BP, changed my shirt, nice, cool locker room. Man's on third, sack fly, first inning. Am I going to cut loose a perfect throw to cut the guy down? I don't know. It's questionable.
Charles Thomas, the batter, takes inside. One ball, no strikes. You talk about the old saying, just happy to be here. Yeah. Here's a guy who's just happy to be here. He hadn't quit smiling since he got off the plane.
I talked to him. He's been here, what, about a week?
Yeah. He is thrilled to death, and he's done a good job for Atlanta. Had a good cut there, but fouled it back. It's 1-1. They're underway in New York. Despite the bad weather, it's no score with the Mets batting at the bottom of the first. Playing the Yankees.
Charles is one of those guys that when the inning ends, he beats half the infielders to the dugout.
Oh, man. It was like he was running on air when I talked to him before the game, and he was just floating to the... He won't be floating now.
No. Slowed him down.
Float like a butterfly, sting like a bee.
That is the 11th batter Arroyo has hit this year. He's only thrown one wild pitch, so he is not afraid to come in on you. He wasn't throwing at him. He was trying to make a pitch down and in. But that's 11 hit batsmen. That's a lot in 74 innings.
I'll give you the quick words that I said to this young Mr. Thomas before the game, that you don't know what kind of player. I'll finish the story next inning.
Right. There you go. Trout Nixon makes the play, and the inning is over. The Braves get a run on the chipper homer, but they trail 2-1 after two. For the Red Sox here in the third inning, Johnny Damon leads it off. He was called out on strikes his first time. He is now 5 out of 12 in his career against Jared Wright. And the third inning is underway. That's upstairs. One ball, no strikes. 2-1 Boston, our score. Damon looks like Jeremiah Johnson or one of those old mountain men.
Tell you this, he can hit. I don't care how long his hair is, he's a good player.
He has scored 100 runs and had at least, has scored at least 100 runs, had at least 30 doubles strict, six straight years. There's a Johnny Damon fan. 2-2, the count.
And he gets on base. Always a high on base percentage, whether by walk or base hit.
Hustles all the time. You gotta like that. Any player, hustle.
You were talking about Charles Thomas a minute ago.
Oh, yes, yes. I was talking to him before the game. Just try to give the young guys a word of advice. And I just told him, you don't know what kind of player that you're going to be. The minor, from the minor leagues to the major leagues. Because once you get here, there may be a coach, someone that can get inside of your head, help you with techniques, fundamental, mental approach to the game, something. And I gave him a good example. I said a Don Mattingly was no bigger, larger than he was. He was a guy that...
Into right field, Drew backs up, now gets turned around, but he's got it. One out. That ball was hit a little better than J.D. thought it was, but he handled it. One away.
And I told him Don Mattingly was a good example. When he came to the Yankees, and I believe in 1984, he was a punch hitter. You know, he hit the ball, flip it to left field. He came to the major leagues, and Lou Piniella had a major influence on him and said, okay, you can keep doing it. Get your hits, get your average, and when they come in on you, I'm going to teach you how to turn on that ball and take advantage of that short right field porch in Yankee Stadium. And you saw him transform from a singles hitter where you didn't have to worry about him to a guy, where are you going to play him? and then I saw him have phenomenal years. Here he is, six feet tall. I'll be generous. Mm-hmm. 6 feet tall, 180 pounds, 175 pounds. And I saw him put up numbers like 35 homers, 145 RBIs, MVP. You never know.
Bellhorn is retired, two down.
David Ortiz put a charge in one his first time up, and with our extra motion, you can track the pitch. Breaking ball down and in, it looked like, and boy, did he golf one out of here. Almost got it into the second deck. And above that concourse there, out in the terrace level.
Prodigious. Mm-hmm. Wow.
He hit it a long way, too.
Yeah.
Fastball away. That seems like a pretty good idea.
Yeah, I think so, unless he hits one back at you, and then you don't want that to happen either.
0-1 the count. 2-1 Boston, our score in the third. Dave Winfield has joined us on Friday Night Extra. The 0-1 pitch, Ortiz steps out as Wright takes a little too much time. Pop foul back and out of play. These Red Sox, a tired team. The emotion of playing the three games before 50,000 in New York is one thing, and then you get played a 13-inning game last night and didn't get to the hotel till around 4:30 this morning. If you wait for your luggage, you know how that goes. That's another half hour, 45 minutes.
The life of the big leaguer.
Yeah. There you go.
And people say, well, so what? They can sleep all day. Well, if you've ever been in a hotel, you know better than that, because the maids don't care what time you got in. They're out there working and talking. And
you hear the trash cans banging in the streets.
That's right. And the guy in the next room gets up early. That's well hit, too, but right at Drew. And the inning is over. So anyway, they're a tired group. But going to the bottom of the third, they lead 2-1. Scenes at his baseball camp. He's a good guy. Really enjoys working with the youngsters. Rafael Furcal leads off the bottom of the third and chops one to first right at the bag, one away.
Rafael took a little slide step to the front of the box. Looked like he might have been looking for that curveball, one to get it before it broke too much, but couldn't do anything with it.
They call that cheating the rule.
Yeah,
got the cheat out, huh? Usually they do that on the fastball. He was doing it on the curve.
So one is out, and Nick Green, the batter. Green struck out on curveballs his first time up there. Arroyo deals his 38th pitch of the night, and it's a fast strike.
Come on, Nick.
2-1 Boston, our score. Same two teams tomorrow night, a 7:05 game. John Thompson and Kurt Schilling pitch that one.
You're now an executive with the Padres, and we understand they've got a beautiful new ballpark. We watched them build that over the last couple of years, but I know they're happy to be in their new stadium, Petco Park.
Gentlemen, there's a lot of good things to tell you about that ballpark. You'll be out there in, the Braves in September?
August.
Uh-huh. I think you'll be duly impressed. Even though the home run output is down, it's probably the lowest in all of baseball right now. I can't tell you what the reason for those factors are, because it isn't markedly different than previous ballpark. But you'll just like it. The dimensions, the little nuances, the places where there are suites for parties for people. There's a variety of things that attract just about anybody to that park. And the weather's always great.
Yeah, great
weather's
location.
Always great.
That, where, no matter where they put the park, you know that about San Diego.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
It's God's country.
And then the gas lamp district downtown.
Yeah,
and the waterfront.
Nice. Strikeout number three for Arroyo.
Fans, become a part of our telecast tonight with Holiday Inn Express in the booth. If you've got a question for us tonight, send us an email, and if we choose it, we'll answer it later in the game. Send your email to tbsmailbag@atlantabraves.com, and please tell us your name and where you're from.
J.D. Drew, the batter, with two out, nobody on. Arroyo goes to work and a drive. Deep right field, and we are tied, and he is red hot. Not quite as far as Ortiz, but a good blast nonetheless. 2-2 our score. been paying attention. He hits a lot of them on the first pitch.
He does that. And watch this short stroke, Dave.
Yes. He tied into that.
Whips in some long home runs hit here tonight already. Three of them.
Let me ask you. Does the ball carry in this park the same as it did in the previous ballpark?
No, I don't think as well. Do you, Joe?
No, I don't. Over in the old launching pad.
Yeah, they called it a launching pad.
It was enclosed, but this one's not, and I don't think it does. Plus, this is a bigger ballpark.
Okay.
Especially the right field, that 390 mark out there in the gap.
Ryan Klesko, Fred McGriff used to just moan and groan about that. Death Valley out in right center. 2-1 the count.
But J.D. Drew red hot. Eighth home run on the first pitch this year.
Does this seem like it's a breakout year for J.D.? He's
healthy year.
Okay. That's a big part of it.
Mm-hmm.
Ortiz to the pitcher, and Arroyo gets there in time. The inning is over. But the Braves have tied the game. We go to the fourth. It's 2-2. We go to the fourth. Brand new ball game. All tied 2-2. Three of the four runs in the game have come as a result of solo homers. Manny Ramirez leads off the fourth inning. Here's the tale of the tape, and I don't know. They say Chippers went 428, Drews went 14, and Ortiz went 405. I thought it was hit better than that.
I'll take Ortiz's shot distance wise. That's more than 405 feet. Sorry. It's 330 to the fence. And you got about 20 rows of seats there. And it landed up there at the top of that exit, right where the lady in the polka dots is sitting. Maybe those are stars. I think it's that's red, white, and blue.
I don't think they're triangulating this correctly.
I don't either. I think that's hometown triangulation. 1-2, the count.
A quick comment on Manny Ramirez up here. I was with Cleveland my last year in 95. Manny was just coming into his own, just starting. And he's demonstrated he's one of the premier players in the American League. Not just one of the highest paid. Forget the dollars. This man can hit.
Yeah,
and for those in the National League, you look at Albert Pujols, who puts up the same kind of numbers. They're a little different style, but they put the ball in play anywhere on the field with power. Can go deep, and they're relentless. There's really nowhere to pitch him. You have to pitch and take your chances.
That team that Cleveland had in 95, boy, was loaded with offense up and down the line. It wasn't a weak spot anywhere.
Till we got to the World Series with you guys.
Uh-huh.
Well, superior announcing prevailed in the World Series.
It usually has something to do with it.
Right. Uh-huh. I wish it had been superior. 3-2 the count. Boy, that's when Kenny Lofton could really play. 95, he was tough. Ramirez draws a leadoff walk.
And as he trots to first, time for tonight's Aflac trivia question. Tonight's question, what two players won the College World Series Outstanding Player Award and then went straight to the major leagues? It's open, only happened twice. We'll give you the answer in the bottom half of the inning.
Oh, let me guess.
Are you going to guess me first?
No, but that brings up an interesting point.
Oh.
One ball, no strikes. Oklahoma was eliminated in the College World Series in a 1-0 game 1 year, if I'm not mistaken.
It was the first game of the tournament.
Who pitched that game against Oklahoma, Joe?
Some great, big, tall, skinny dude from Minnesota. Wasn't all that skinny either, but boy, he could pitch.
Base hit Garcia Parra and trouble bruise for Atlanta in the fourth. That would be Dave Winfield, who a lot of people don't remember was an outstanding college pitcher.
Oh, vicious. Tough. Oh.
Venomous.
Looks like Hank Aaron turning those wrists. What can I tell you? Wow, look at that. Look at these pictures. would you?
1-0, and we had the bases loaded in the ninth inning. What'd you say? You'd thrown about 140 pitches or
something like that. And for those who don't know, we won 1-0, struck out 14 guys, bases loaded, I think full count, and the guy swung at a pitch right out of the strike zone.
Mike Ford.
Oh, man, I was never so happy to get out of a jam. It's a great game, great game.
I know Mike's happy to remember that.
A couple of teammates, Bob Shirley was on your team, and another teammate during the summer, Jackson Todd.
You guys played together in Alaska, huh?
Exactly. But for those who don't know, I pitched until the last day in college at the University of Minnesota. And then when I signed up with the Padres, first day, left field. Left field, can you believe that?
And that was that.
And quick, and I'll wait.
Can they get two? There's one.
Wow.
The toughest double play in baseball.
Wow.
The 3-6-1. It comes in a big spot for Atlanta. Runner at third, two out.
Good quick feed by LaRoche, and that gave Furcal an opportunity to pick his spot where he was going to lead Jarrett Wright. And good hustle by Wright. Good play to catch and then tag the bag.
Exceptional play. Good athleticism by Jarrett Wright, because you have to time it. You have to catch the ball, keep your eye on it, find the bag, beat the guy over there, not get run over or injured.
That was pretty.
Very nice.
Jason Veritek singled his first time. Comes up empty here. It's 0-1.
Another quick story. Here I am early at the game, and I saw the scout who drafted me. He is the scout for Tampa Bay. I'll give Donnie Williams.
Is that right?
Yeah.
Yeah, Donnie used to be with us.
Yeah, and although he went through some health problems, it's good to see he's looking well.
Yeah.
And my best always goes out to him and his family.
A ball and a strike to count. Runner at third, but two are out now.
Doesn't happen very often that a player goes straight to the big leagues from college. Braves had a very good player in Bob Horner who did that. But was that a huge adjustment, not just on the field, but being thrown into the lifestyle of Major League Baseball right away, too?
Yeah.
Veritek knew it. The inning is over, and Wright gets out of a major mess. In the fourth, we go to the bottom half, still tied.
Old-timers know.
Bottom of the fourth, Johnny Estrada leads it off. There's the story of the game. It's 2-2. Chipper Jones, J.D. Drew have homered for Atlanta. David Ortiz hit one for the Red Sox. Their other run was driven in on a Bill Miller single, scoring Jason Veritek. So that's where we are as we go to the bottom of the fourth, and Damon on his horse will get there. One out.
And with one out, we'll give you the answer to tonight's Aflac trivia question. The question was, what two players won the College World Series Outstanding Player Award and went straight to the major leagues? Well, we figured you probably knew one was Dave Winfield. And we mentioned Bob Horner. I didn't know that he had been the MVP of the College World Series while with Arizona State.
I didn't, but he was a big hitter.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, Bob went right here, and he was hitting home runs.
He was
played a good third base, but he was known for his hitting, not his fielding.
If he hadn't hurt his shoulder, and if he and his agent had gotten along with Braves management better, he'd have been even better. 1-1 the count, but a terrific guy and a fine player.
He might have started that thing about no infield, didn't he?
He was amongst them.
He didn't like too much infield.
We were talking about adjustments, though, and coming from college to the major league level and how difficult it can be.
You know, that's, we could talk a long time about that, but the adjustments, they're just the major, it's a major leap forward. Mentally, physically, the amount of games that you play.
Every day.
You're playing against people who are your heroes and your idols. I had their pictures on my wall. I got Hank Aaron and Willie Mays and Bob Gibson and Marichal. They're on my wall. All of a sudden, I'm playing against these guys, kind of in awe. The first time Willie Mays hit a ball to me in the outfield, it was a Texas leaguer, and I'm shaking when I caught it.
Manny Ramirez makes the catch, two out.
And this is something that you tell people, and I was even talking to Pedro Martinez from the pitching aspect of it, but before the game. But we're talking about the adjustments you need to make while you're in the major leagues. I played 22 years, made four major adjustments as a hitter to remain competitive and on top of my game. You make adjustments. Your eyesight changes, your physical being changes. And Pedro Martinez was commenting the same thing. He's not the same pitcher in terms of trying to overpower people on every pitch, every game. He got hurt a few years ago, and he made adjustments. That's what you have to do in this game, adjust.
There's a fine running catch by Nixon. Three fly balls. The inning is over. Let's send it back to our studios and Mark Fine. Mark.
All right. Thanks very much, Skip. Welcome back to TV.
Thank you very much. Bill Miller leads it off here. He drove in a run with a base hit his first time. Here's how it sounded, and here's how Julio Franco saw it.
He ain't gonna score on that ball, I guarantee you that. He ain't gonna score on that ball. Hey, got him!
Sorry, Julio. You may be right, but you're wrong. And Miller takes a strike, and the fifth inning is underway.
Julio had a great perspective, too. He was only about 95 feet away.
The far end of the dugout.
Yes.
But he's in the game. He's always in the game.
Oh, he's terrific.
You're talking about adjustments a minute ago, and we had a shot of Julio. Talk about a guy who, at age 45, does what he has to do. He still has that big bat-wrapped stance, but he still gets the head of the bat on the ball more times than not.
Oh, yeah. I looked at his bat, and he uses one of the larger bats in baseball.
Yeah.
He uses anywhere from 35 and a half inches to 36 inches long, and he usually swings about 35 ounces.
Yeah. That's one thing that was curious about you, though. You had a real small bat, didn't you, when you first came to the big leagues?
No, actually, I usually use the longer bat than most, usually 35 and a half inches. Always 35 and a half, sometimes a 36. It just looks small hands next to me, you know, big guy. But I used a pretty big bat. But for those who want to know about hitting, it's either you can be a good hitter if you're quick, or you can be a good hitter if you're strong, and the best hitters are quick and strong. And Julio still has good bat speed. And there's only one other person that I've seen that really has an unusual swing as he does, where he tips the head of that bat forward. Remember Dick Allen?
Sure.
Dick Allen was the person. He's all, again, diminutive in size, large forearms. He would just dip the head of that bat toward the pitcher, and when it came back around, bam! He was pretty awesome.
I saw him play in the minor leagues. I was working here during the Atlanta Crackers when they were in the International League, and he was playing for the Arkansas team. Well, when he was young, before he tore up his legs, and what a prospect he was.
Oh, yeah.
And he's still got one of the great lines in the history of baseball. They asked him about playing on artificial turf. You know, he was a horse breeder. Said, if my horse can't eat it, I don't want to play on it.
He's a very good example. He's really a nice gentleman if you got to know him. But if you don't take care of your body or take care of the game, you never get in as much time as you would like. And he was a friend, but he didn't take care of the game or his body, and it made a difference.
The payoff pitch, foul tipped at home plate. Johnny couldn't hang on. Count stays the same. Tampa Bay leads Florida tonight, 2-1 in the fifth. Mark will keep you up to date on all the other baseball, all the particulars as we go along here this evening. Fly ball, trouble if it's fair down the left field line, but look at Thomas run. Boy, he is a good-looking outfielder, one away. He covered a lot of ground to get to that ball. Out in the fifth.
He plays like he's enjoying it, Skip. That's what I enjoy so much about watching him. He's having fun. Close the gap on that in a hurry.
Was he in AAA?
Yes, leading the International League in hitting.
358.
Very good.
But again, he wasn't even in spring training with the big club. He sort of came out of nowhere. Not too many of us knew anything about him when he got called up.
Bronson Arroyo, the batter, takes the strike.
How many times has that happened to young players? You just have to be ready. Keep preparing yourself. You never know when your opportunity is.
And when you get it, then you better cash in because you might not get another one.
Everybody's heard of Wally Pipp, right?
Yeah, exactly.
So I don't feel good today. Lou Gehrig stepped in.
3,000 games later, Wally Pipp still wasn't feeling good. That does it for Arroyo. Let's send it to Mark Fine. Mark.
Thanks, Skip. Time for today's Baby Ruth Real Deal, and it goes to Jack Wilson. Pittsburgh already up 6-1 in the sixth. Wilson roping one off Bruce Kieschnick. It gets away from Brady Clark. Jason Kendall scores. Run, Jack. Run like the wind. There it is inside the Parker. Today's Baby Ruth Real Deal. Gets back to the ball.
Thank God he was all right. He looked like he was totally spent. He had slammed on the brakes at third base, had to get it revved up again.
Can you believe that's exactly like my only inside the Parker?
Really?
I did that in Chicago White Sox, probably 83 or 84. Hit a high one off the left center field wall, and it kicked towards center. And you're running around. It's a hot, muggy summer day. Get to home plate.
You want to stop, don't you?
Oh, man. Only thing you can do is lay out. Head first slide, safe.
Because you're going to fall down anyway.
Exactly.
0-2, count on Damon. Jared Wright pitching a fine ball game. Arroyo has pitched well, too. No hits, no runs, no errors, nobody left. Bottom of the fifth, 2-2.
Don't wait another minute for... Braves TBS Baseball Friday Night Extra, brought to you by Krylon Fusion, the original no-prep Super Bond paint for plastic. And Office Depot, what you need to know.
Bottom of the fifth, Charles Thomas leads it off for Atlanta, 2-2 ball game.
Chop House is busy tonight. A little muggy and everybody getting refreshed out there.
A lot of us getting primed for the Peachtree Road Race coming up on Sunday.
I wish you luck, Skip.
The 0-1 pitch.
Is that
a bit outside?
Is that race on the streets or is it on the? Is that right? Okay.
Yeah, every year I plan to run, and every year I oversleep. Into left center. Damon's not going to get there. Look at him run. He's going to stop. And a good start for Atlanta in the fifth. Runner at second. Jared Wright will try to move him over.
Charles not just getting hits. He's getting extra base hits. This is his eighth hit, third double to go with a triple. And Wisely, with nobody out, decided to pull up at second base to get an inning started with a double.
He's had sort of an unusual career. His first year in the rookie league at Jamestown, he hit 303. Then he went to high A ball in 01, hit 159 at Myrtle Beach.
Wow.
They sent him down to Macon, lower classification of A ball. He only hit 250. Then he hit 231 in Greenville. Then last year he went back to Myrtle Beach and hit only 242. The bunt right in front of the plate, and he is out. Good play by Veritek, a bad bunt by Jared. He didn't get it out far enough, and it cost him.
This is a case when you're a rookie and you're trying to make your mark. You see the ball down, you're going to break the third. You just figure the guy's done his job, and it's hard from second base to determine that the ball's right out in front of home plate.
You're absolutely right. But with more experience, you're going to watch where the ball is put into play, not if it is put into play.
Right.
You don't guess. You have to make adjustments once it's put down and in play.
You know, you were talking about some coach is going to get inside your head. Well, I don't know what happened with Charles Thomas, but last year he went back to Myrtle Beach and A-ball hit 242. So it looked like his career was stalled, but for some reason they saw something. They moved him up to Greenville. And he hit 324 the second half of the year. It's like something clicked. And then this year he's hitting 358 when he got called up, and he's hitting 300 in the big league.
Well, you know, as you said, there are a lot of intangibles in baseball because there's a lot of There's physical tools that come into play, of course, and God-given ability. A lot comes into the mental approach.
Oh, you bet.
And then there's the science of playing. There's the technical parts of playing baseball. It's not like we play little league or high school ball or college ball. Every level there are nuances that if you don't make the adjustments, you say, well, what happened? You know, I played winter ball 1 year in Mexico, and I'll tell you in a moment.
Base hit for call, first and second, one out.
I played very good at every level that I played. All the way, you know, American Legion, college, you know, first year in the big leagues. I go to the play in Mexico. They released me after about 2 months. Never happened in my life. I couldn't make the adjustment to the style of ball. And this young man, he's learning. If I could, you know, if people can learn while you're in the big leagues, first 10, 12 years, most people don't play that long. So
right.
You've got to, when does it click in? And I'll tell you this. In summary, it's kind of like every ball player tries to find that key to unlock their talent to help them continually improve and succeed at this level. Some people find it, some don't. How many people have you seen with a lot of ability and they somehow never make it at the big leagues?
Oh, a lot. The can't miss prospect that misses.
Yeah.
It happens all the time.
The draft choices that were very high draft choices, and guys that were drafted in the 30th round bypass them like a streak.
I read the book by Billy Bean. What the book about
Moneyball?
Moneyball. He'll tell you. Here's a guy who was drafted higher than Daryl Strawberry, same time. I mean, he had a lot of ability, and he said, "I can't handle the pressure." He looked at guys like Lenny Dykstra and Daryl Strawberry and said, these guys aren't afraid of these pitchers. Lenny Dykstra would come up and say, who's this guy pitching today? Oh, don't worry, that's Tom Seaver. Forget Tom Seaver. I'm getting three hits tonight. And Billy Bean is scared to death. He said, I can't handle the pressure.
The curveball gets Green again. He's had a tough night. The hat trick, three strikeouts. Here's Drew, and here's what he did last time.
Put some extra motion on this pitch, too. It's the first pitch to him in this sequence. Fastball. It was trying to tail away from him, but not far enough. It was launched. Tail to thick, they say, 417 feet.
Well, let's see if he can do it again.
Wow. Well, we'll just comment on Green that just struck out again. While they're eating him up inside, he's a young man. He's only been up here, what, a month?
Six weeks.
And it's hard. You don't know what they're doing to you. You haven't had enough experience to know exactly what the other team is trying to do to you. And it's constantly making adjustments. And it's at bat to at bat. If you succeed against them one way, they're going to make an adjustment. And if they keep getting you out a certain way, they're going to keep pounding them in.
Something else, too, Dave, is he's had a pretty good run here these 6 weeks. He hasn't had too many rough games, but it's how you bounce back from a three-strikeout night, too.
Exactly.
Do you dwell on it the next day? Does it stay with you? And how quickly he forgets about it and goes on to the next at-bat and next game.
And that varies from person to person. Mm-hmm. Do you internalize it? Do you take it out on the bat rack? Do you get sleep? Do you analyze what you need to do? Is it more practice? Is it less practice? Is it something fundamental that's out of kilter? You don't know. And that may be what's going through his mind. And some people think too much. Yogi Berra said, I can't think and hit at the same time.
They're loaded with two outs for Chipper Jones. Another thing about young players, Dave, my partner, old partner Ernie Johnson, who you know, had an interesting theory, and I think it makes a lot of sense. You come out of high school and you're drafted by a major league team. Well, you were a star. You were the best player probably in your high school, maybe the best player in your district. But now you show up in the rookie league, and everybody else was a star in their district, too. So all of a sudden, you're not head and shoulders above everybody else.
Right.
Some people can make that adjustment, and some people can't. They just, if I'm not the big deal, I can't perform.
Exactly. It happens even at earlier levels. You go to college,
right.
Everybody's all city, all state,
right.
All American. Everybody's that way. Who can fight their way through it are the ones that succeed.
They even now have, and I think it's a bad idea, but they do it in Little League. They have traveling teams in the summer where they take the best Little Leaguers from all these districts, and they play against one another. I think that's putting too much pressure on the kids myself. Well,
but that's where the sport is going. I was telling you early on, it's no longer you go to the recreation center and you get good coaching and it's free and you can play all the way up till you're drafted. It's no longer that way.
High fly ball, left field, pretty well hit. Not well enough. Manny Ramirez on the fringe of the track, and the inning is over. Braves leave them loaded after five, 2-2.
It's a long way from here to the 19th hole. A wise man provisions himself accordingly.
Baseball Kids, a new feature highlighting stories of youth baseball in America. So parents, if you have a great story about youth baseball in your community today, we want to hear about them. Send us your story in 50 words or less to youthbaseball@atlantabraves.com. Over the next several weeks, we'll pick the best stories for Braves TBS Baseball Kids, and we will come out to your community. Go to atlantabraves.com to view official rules. And don't forget to include your name, address, phone number, and age in your email.
And be sure and send in your personal story for your kids to youthbaseball@atlantabraves.com. And TBS Baseball Kids will come to your ballpark. They'll tape your story, and it could be on TBS during Braves Friday Night Extra in August or September. That'll be a fun feature to track and see some stories about some kids who may be stars, but they may also be kids who have overcome various things to be able to play Little League Baseball.
No matter what, is youth baseball great or what?
Oh,
it really is.
Yeah.
If the parents would just back off. But that's another subject for another time. Mark Bellhorn takes a strike. It's 0-1. My son's 22 now, but I was on the board of directors of our Little League when he was a little guy. We had no trouble at all with the kids, but some of the parents, boy.
Yeah, yeah.
Screaming at the kids, screaming at the umpires.
No, that's...
And it's easy to do because you want yours to succeed so bad, you know?
But, you know, I think the best thing I could take away from... Little League Baseball or youth sports, the coaches are many times the people that you remember your whole life.
That's right.
The lessons that you learn from them working with the kids.
That's absolutely right. And there may be some stories coming out of this with TBS Baseball Kids. There might be some great stories about some coaches who have done some wonderful things and made some sacrifices for youth baseball.
1-2, the count. Mark Bellhorn takes high and the count evens up. Two balls, two strikes. We got a 2-2 ball game. The line score is identical, 2-4-0.
I think about now, Boston's looking for a laugher, don't you think?
Yeah. They're not going to get it that way. One away.
Well, we were talking about youth baseball, David, and apparently there's another David Winfield who is on the rise.
Ah,
how about that?
You got my son. He's pitching. Age 9, it's West L.A. Little League. Look at that. Look at that.
Look at that head on the ball.
Oh, man. Keep that head. Keep that eye right on the ball.
Where'd he learn that?
Well, you know, I teach him a little bit. You know?
That's allowed.
That is great. That is great, guys.
David Ortiz, the batter, and it's foul back, 0-1.
You mentioned Laffer, and that brings me to something I was going to bring up about coming into a ball, into a city late after a tough series with the Yankees. They lose all three. Extra innings last night. You start a game on adrenaline, but boy, right around here, right around the fifth inning, now they're into the sixth, all of a sudden that fatigue sets in and you start mentally really having to push yourself to hang into a ball game.
You know, they've been through a mentally draining series. They could have been 2.5 games behind the New York Yankees. After a three-game series, they're 8.5 behind. Takes a lot out of you. But you can never give in. You can never give up. It's a long season. They're still an exceptional ball club. And they still may have to look for a wild card, but you have to do a lot of winning just to be in that position as well.
0-2, the count to David Ortiz.
That's where baseball's so different than all the other sports. There's no letting up. You play every night.
Just missed inside. He's got a good fastball tonight, 92 miles an hour. Dave, do you agree with us that the radar gun is overrated? it's a good tool, but you can't just go by the speed of the baseball. It's if it's
not at all
straight as a string, it doesn't matter, does it?
Yeah, no. Pitching is about location,
yeah,
movement, as well as speed. And the pitchers that know how to mix it up, how to move the ball around. And a great example, I mean, I was talking to Leo Mazzoni before the game. He was talking about Jarrett Wright. Now, he was in San Diego, and he had been a few other places, experienced some injuries over the past couple of years. But when he first started, it was only on speed. How fast can I throw it? And he was wild as heck. And he's learning. He's talking to Leo and other people. Throw at 90% of your capabilities. Hit the spots. Own a part of the plate. Own low and away. Mix it up. And Pedro Martinez, we're talking the same thing. He doesn't throw 100% of with effort every pitch. Location, movement, arm angle. Resort to your best pitch when you need to get someone out on a strikeout.
2-2, the count to Ortiz.
The best examples, you've had people on the Braves over the last 12, 14 years. These guys locate. Glavin can't blow it by you.
No.
Maddux couldn't blow it by you. Look at those records.
Good play by Adam LaRue. Two down. Here's Ramirez. Yeah, Maddux has won 296 games now, I think, right in that area.
Has he ever thrown 95 miles per hour?
Never in his life. Ramirez has struck out and walked. Ortiz walking very slowly off the field. I don't know if he hurt himself or not. He's walking sort of funny. And Jarrett Wright ready to go to work.
This is a typical Jarrett Wright game, isn't it, Skip? I mean, he's just pitching his tail off and having to fight for everything he gets, and not enough run support to really be able to relax on any inning.
Has that been his luck of the draw this
year?
Pretty
much.
But last year his earned run average was 8.5 at San Diego, so he's got to be happy about the way things have gone despite the lack of support. The Phillies have taken the lead now over Baltimore, but it's early. It's 6-5. They're in the fourth. That's all Philadelphia is doing anymore. They score 10 runs a night and give up either 11 or 9, it seems like, lately. There's catcher cam. 1-2, the count. Pitch number 96 coming up for Jarrett Wright. We are in the sixth in a tie game. Joe Simpson, Skip Carey, Dave Winfield has joined us on Friday Night Extra. And Wright's 2-2 pitch. And he's run it full. 3 balls, 2 strikes.
Brian Moyer looked it up for me, Skip. In 8 of Jarrett's previous 15 starts, the game was decided by 2 runs or less. And over half of them.
We'll have it to do again. Still 3 balls, 2 strikes.
Can you believe it? Jared's had arm trouble and surgery, and this guy, he's consistently throwing 96, 95, 97 miles per hour that last pitch.
And that's doing it, like you said, without 100% effort, just nice and easy.
That's maybe the best fastball he's had all year, if he's up at 96 or thereabouts.
He's using it. Yeah, and he's using it too. Another 97.
Another payoff pitch to Manny Ramirez with 2 out and nobody on. 7 for Jared Wright. We go to the bottom of the sixth, still tied.
Friday Night Extra, brought to you by The Home Depot. Go from wondering how to knowing how. At The Home Depot, you can do it. We can help. And Wachovia, talk to us.
Johnny Estrada ready to lead it off. Bronson Arroyo deals his 75th pitch of the night. And a curve ball curves around the plate. One ball, no strikes. 2-2 our score. Good ball game from Atlanta. Hope you're enjoying it.
Here's a guy, Dave, that 2 years ago was the catcher, the all-star catcher in the International League. Then he gets traded to the Braves. Thought he had another opportunity to go to another organization, but there's Javi Lopez having a great year. Mm. He gets sent back to the International League. He's the all-star again. He could have folded his tent and pouted a little bit, but he didn't. Lined that one hard to third. Now time for tonight's Holiday Inn Express in the booth question. It comes from Sherry Kinkle from Citrus Heights, California, who wants to know, why do division standings show half games when baseball games don't end in ties? Well, Sherry, it's because teams are playing at different paces and they don't all have the exact same number of games played. For example, San Francisco 44-35 has played 79 games. The Dodgers have played 76 games, so there's a difference in there of three games, which would include a half game. That's why they have to include half games.
Base hit for Adam LaRoche.
If everybody played exactly the same number of games, there wouldn't be a half game difference anywhere.
And at the end of the year, if everybody plays their full schedule, there won't be, but.
Yes.
I love it when you do math, man. You're my hero.
Exceptional.
You just have to put a little on and take a little off.
Andrew Jones, the batter, go ahead, run at first with one out.
Who is your favorite player to watch play?
Well, I'll give you a couple.
Okay.
I enjoyed watching Hank Aaron make his run for 715.
1-4, bad throw, but they get the double play nonetheless. And the inning is over, and Dave will tell you his other choice when we come back at the end of 6, 2-2. His other special talent, which is writing.
You may or may not know, I do a little writing. I'm an aspiring novelist, and Longstreet Press coming out with a book of mine called Legends, Demons, and Dreams. Sort of a fictional account of my life. I would hope that a lot of people would buy my book and read about my early life. Basically, that's what most of my books will be about, baseball in the 30s and the 40s. Hope that that'll be a good second career for me out here.
Legends, Demons, and Dreams, the name of that book, Longstreet Press. It's available now at all fine bookstores. You said Henry Aaron, one of your favorites. Who else?
The other is Ricky Henderson. But I'll tell you, watching Henry Aaron, because when I got here, just to watch someone pursuing one of the greatest records of all time, not 60 in a season, but 700-plus home runs. And so I'm playing against them to try to beat these guys, beat the Braves, but always secretly pulling for him to do well. So that was something. And then Ricky Henderson, because he was just one of the best players in the history of the game. He was as fast as anybody. I mean, his all-time stolen base record. We got about four seasons together, and to watch a guy to come and play with that verve and that enthusiasm and do everything, hit for average, hit for power, steal bases, walks, score runs. He turned the tide of so many games with his ability, so I give Ricky a lot of credit.
Nomar Garciaparra is one out of two. As you can see, Antonio Alfonseca is on to pitch for Atlanta. And a looper into right field. Drew coming hard, but he cannot get there. It pops away, but not far enough for Garcia Parra to advance.
Tough play for JD. That was a full swing Garcia Parra made, and it sounded loud, like he hit it harder than he did, and JD got a late start on it. Can't fault him for the way he's been playing, though, and out there. He's been outstanding defensively.
Trout Nixon is the batter. Jared Wright went six innings, four hits, two runs, a walk, seven strikeouts. Talking about Henry Aaron, let's face it, not only was he chasing the record, but he was a black man in the Deep South chasing the record and got a lot of hate mail and had to deal with all that, too.
Yeah, times were a lot different. When we talk about that to young people, and here it is in 2000, people don't, many times, don't even relate to it. Why did that happen? Why did people look at it different? Why were things separate? My kids don't relate to that. Most kids don't nowadays.
Be nice when nobody does.
Yeah. I was going to comment on Nomar. You see that last play that just blooper to right field? First of all, he's a first pitch guy too. He loves that first pitch. But those kind of plays, he's in a funk. He's early in his comeback. Those kind of hits, all of a sudden you see a little smile on his face down there, a little smirk. Though you need those to get you jump started sometimes. It's not the line drives, it's those bloopers. You say thank you.
Take everyone.
Exactly.
A ball and a strike to count. That is not Pedro Martinez heating up in the bullpen.
No, that's Martinez, who just got called up.
Who's not on the roster yet.
Long first name.
Clever D's or something like that.
Anastasio
Martinez.
Little hit and run for the Red Sox there. They don't do that very much. Could be just a straight steal for Garcia Parra. He got a good jump off Alfonseca.
The go-ahead run at first, nobody out. Raining in St. Louis, where the Mariners hope to play. Texas leads Houston 3-1 in the fifth. Texas leads the West.
Played in both leagues. Which one did you like the best? Do you like the DH? You still like the DH if you do?
Early career, when I was in the National League, I said, what is this DH thing? A guy that can't play?
Tell me about late in your career.
Oh, man, when I was about 38, I tell the people, look, would you rather see me hit or some pitcher? We'd rather see you hit. All right, I rest my case.
Strike three called inside corner. Nixon knew it.
Good backup fastball here. It came back over the inside corner. Trout gave up on it too early. Good pitch.
Had he swung, there was nothing he could do with that. Make a lamp out of the bat. That's about it.
Yeah.
Saw it right off.
Jason Varitek, the hitter. One on, one out. Varitek singled and scored in the second, called out on strikes in the fourth. Jared Wright cannot get a decision in this game, but he pitched a perfect ball game. So has Bronson Arroyo. Give him credit too. Hard to believe Arroyo's 2-7 watching him pitch tonight.
Yeah, and lost his last six starts.
Really?
Yeah.
Explain the multicolored boxes to me.
You can't see them out there, can you?
That's a virtual leadoff box. That gives you an idea, gives the fans at home an idea about how far off Garcia Parra is leading off. 9-foot lead. He's got a 6-foot lead plus a step for a dive back. Anything beyond that's pretty good lead, wouldn't you guess?
I'd say so. You know, the master of the stolen base is Lou Brock. Lou Brock had it down to a science. You could not pick him off, and he could steal, and he would pop-up slide. No hit first slide.
Double play ball, 4-6-3. The inning is over. Dave, thanks for spending some time with us, man. We appreciate it.
Gentlemen, it was my pleasure.
Very enjoyable.
Really. Thanks. Good to see you.
Good to see you. We'll be back right after this.
The Atlanta Braves, fighting for a 13th straight division title.
And he faces the lower end of the Atlanta order, but that starts with the number eight hitter, Charles Thomas, who has doubled and been hit by a pitch. Eli Marrero moves on deck to pinch it for Alfonseca. There's activity in the Atlanta bullpen. Can't see who it is at this moment, but we'll let you know in a minute. Bobby Cox was talking before the game. He's got a dilemma in left field. Eli Marrero's playing well enough that he should be playing every day, except Charles Thomas is playing so good he should be playing every day.
It's a good platoon right now.
Ground ball to second. Bellhorn has it. Better hurry. One out. Let's take a look at our Wagner box score as Eli Marrero comes out to pinch hit. Drew and Chipper Jones, the home runs for Atlanta, as you see.
Bronson Arroyo, in his last six games, he's 0-6, a 5.79 ERA. His last five starts have been against National League teams. Oh boy, he's pitching a gem tonight.
And Marrero comes up empty, pulled off that ball a little bit, 0-1 the count. Eli has been doing very well. He's up to 303 with five homers and 19 RBIs. This is his 100th at bat, and he hits a little dunker toward third. Miller gloves it and throws him out. Two down.
Looks like Bill Miller's knee is feeling okay. Just off the disabled list today. Had to make a quick reaction on that one and throw on the run. Last year's American League batting champion, and we've talked a lot about all year long about Braves injuries, and the Red Sox certainly have had their share of injuries with Garcia Parra out, Trot Nixon out at the beginning of the year, missing that guy for a couple of weeks.
Miller's been with the Giants, the Cubs, the Giants again, and now the Red Sox. 326 last year, as Joe told you. That led the league. Phillies 6-5 over Baltimore now. They're in the sixth. Florida has tied Tampa Bay 2-2 in the seventh. With the passing of every day, it looks more and more like first to pitch is a strike. Nobody's going to pull away in this Eastern Division. It's just going to be a dogfight, a war of attrition till the end of the year.
Yeah, but I think you got to keep your eye on the Phillies right now.
If they get any pitching.
Yeah. The way they're swinging the bat, their lineup is swinging now and scoring now like everybody expected them to. And while no one has really jumped out and run away with the division, no one's really had any hot streaks, Philadelphia looks like they're primed to do that.
That takes care of Percal, and that takes care of the seventh inning. It's still 2-2.
Not too close. What do you think? I got.
And Bill Miller takes the strike. Kevin Millar has moved on deck to pinch hit next for Bronson Arroyo. He did his job, as did Jared Wright, and there's a base hit up the middle for Miller. He didn't hit it hard, but he hit it in a perfect spot. Now let's see what they do. They call Millar back. He's a guy they hope will hit some home runs for them. And they'll go instead to Kevin Youkilis. And a pinch runner will be employed as well. That looks like Pokey Reese, and it is.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's kind of the way Bill Miller plays. He's a guy that hits the ball, puts it in play, and finds holes. His little looper to right field is what scored Veritek with their second run tonight. But they're happy to have him back in the lineup.
So Youkilis stands in there. Hitting 299, three homers, 19 RBIs. His first pinch hit appearance of the year.
You don't use too many pinch hitters over in that league.
No, that's right.
I have to admit, though, David McCarty has quite a few. He has the most pinch hit appearances on their team with 16. Braves have four different guys in double figures.
Euculus was swinging away, but he took it inside. One ball, no strikes.
That was a little surprising. Dale Swain, former Major League infielder, third base coach.
Bill Hasselman over at first. They chase the runner back. Houston closing in on Texas. It's 3-2 now in the sixth. Still raining in St. Louis.
Jerry Francona, of course, first year manager for Boston, managed in the National League before.
He was with the Phillies prior to Larry Boa. Bob Brenly getting fired. That's hard to believe. That's the same Bob Brenly that seems like just moments ago led him to a world title.
Mm-hmm.
He hasn't changed. 2-1 the count.
Boy, with that big an overhaul, though, there was something fishy, something big going on over there. Robin Yount resigning, pitching coach getting fired along with him. Not a complete overhaul, but pretty close.
The 2-1 pitch, runner going, swung and missed the throw. Got it. Good throw, Estrada. Pokey Reese cut down.
Boy, this is a quick release by Estrada. Good jump by Pokey. Took a look over his shoulder, but seemed to slow down when he hit the dirt.
That head first slide seems to do that more often than not. Bang, bang play. I don't know, but that he got in there. Full count now, 3-2. But he didn't argue about it, so
no.
He must have felt he was out. And that makes the caught stealing hurt the Red Sox that much more.
Rietsma couldn't stand the prosperity. Got rid of one base runner and added another.
Top of the order, and Johnny Damon, the batter. Johnny Estrada to the mound. Mets now 7-0 over the Yankees. That's an official game now. They're in the sixth inning. Tampa Bay has reclaimed a 4-2 lead over Florida in the seventh. Cleveland hammering the Reds 9-2 in the seventh. Runner at first, one out. Damon takes outside, one ball, no strikes. John Thompson, a Braves nemesis down through the years, Kurt Schilling. Those are the pitching pairings tomorrow. Pete and Don will have that for you at 7 o'clock Eastern time. And they'll have Monday's 105 game as well, as Mike Hampton and Derek Lowe oppose one another. 2-0 the count. Rietsma struggling.
Braves have done a good job to keep Damon off the bases so far tonight, but Rietsma behind in the count.
I think Rietsma's one guy that's really going to benefit from the All-Star break. He has thrown a lot for Atlanta.
Mm-hmm. Been in a lot of games, more games than anybody. Damon has been on base two or more times in 33 of the last 46 games. That's working your way on.
Yes, sir. 2-0 pitch. 3-0 the count. Rietsma fighting it. I don't believe the bullpen is busy for Atlanta, but that's subject to change here. We're in the eighth inning. We're tied 2-2, one on, one out. There's a strike at the knees, 3-1.
If they put another play on here.
Yep. And a fly ball down the right field line. Trouble if it's fair, it is hooking foul. A noisy strike two and a full count the result.
Put Even nice hit and run play when you almost hit the ball out of the ballpark.
Yeah.
Everybody can slow down and trot. Euclid has a few stolen bases in his professional career, but doesn't run that well and might get a strike and not throw him out.
Ground ball to second. They go to second. Everybody's safe. I don't know if Percal got surprised by the throw or what, but the Braves failed to execute, and two are on with one out.
I don't think Nick got much on this toss, Skip. He was trying to get it out of his glove and just lunged at Rafael and threw it into the path of the runner. And Percal was trying to come across the bag to get out of Euclid's way in order to make a throw to first. And that combined with that throw nearer the bag, closer to the bag, made it tough for Rafi to come up with it.
We'll see how they score it. It could just be a fielder's choice. More likely, it'll be an error. And they give the error to Percal. And looking at the replay, I'm not so sure, but what it should have been on green.
Yeah, I agree. Let's take another look here. See if it was a good toss to the bag. Again, it was kind of a lunge here. And Percal is having to reach across the runner. Granted, it was toward the bag, but not in a good spot to help try to turn the double play. They give it to Percal despite that.
Mark Bellhorn bats with two on and one out. One ball, no strikes. Red Sox have had a runner thrown out on the bases in this inning, and they have two on and one out. Took a little off, and the count evens at one and one. A great crowd on hand, 42,321.
Another breaking ball might be a good idea after Bellhorn was over the top of the last one.
Line, left field, base hit. They will stop the runner, and the bases are loaded. And David Ortiz will be the batter. He's got tremendous power. You can double him up if you get a ground ball. So things have not gone too swimmingly for Chris Rietzma in this game.
But it started, actually, after he got taken off the hook when they threw Pokey Reese out, he then walked the pinch hitter, and that's what really led to all this.
Infield back for Atlanta. A ground ball could result in a double play.
Part as this guy hits the ball, the infielders are very happy to play back.
You bet. Brave playing straight away in the outfield. 0-1.
Great
strikeout would work very nicely here.
Super changeup, great motion, terrific location.
Ortiz has driven in 76 runs this year. Euclid at third, Damon at second, Bellhorn at first, one out. A ball and a strike. 2-7-0 for the Red Sox, 2-5-1 for the Braves. They play him, as you might expect, very deep. And a high pop into short left field. Thomas comes on. Euclid tags. Here's the catch. He won't try. And it wasn't a real good throw. Manny Ramirez bats with the bases loaded and two out.
Very conservative play here by the Red Sox, I think, Skip. I understand that this is not a real deep fly ball, but typically teams don't have their best arm in left field. They know it's a rookie. Maybe the lack of confidence in Euclid's speed contributed to that decision, but with the game on the line, I think I got to test it.
It's all up to Manny Ramirez. He has struck out twice, walked once. He's driven in 62 runs and leads the league in homers.
Look at these Braves fans on their feet.
Strike, 0-1. They shade him slightly toward right. Strike two. 96 miles an hour with that one.
Well, Chris has got to be pumped up the way this crowd has reacted to getting Ortiz out. They are fired up.
Don't have to throw a strike here. Nothing and two to count. Ramirez never got the bat off his shoulder. And the Red Sox blow a great chance to score. Bottom of the eighth coming up.
You'd never hear this from John, but he...
into a mess, but then he got out of a mess in the top half of the eighth inning. Here's Manny Ramirez. Fast strike. Fast strike. Fast strike at the knees. And he got himself out of the inning. And we go to the bottom half of the eighth inning. Nick Green leads it off, and Alan Embry is on to pitch. Pokey Reese stays in the game to play second base. Mark Bellhorn moves to third. 2-2 our score. Green struck out three straight times against Arroyo. Now he's got the hard-throwing former Brave on the mound. And a fastball must have been low. One ball, no strikes. You see the numbers on Embry for the year. Allen's always had good stuff. His control at times a problem for him.
But just 10 walks in 30 innings this year. That's a good number for him.
Chopper, third. Bellhorn, good play. One out.
Wow.
That ball gets over his head. Garcia Parra has no chance to throw him out.
Timed his leap perfectly. Right at the top of his jump. Gets that one in the web and throws him out. Good play.
J.D. Drew has walked, struck out, and hit a long home run. Strike on the corner, nothing and one. 2-2 our score in the eighth.
Embry's in there to pitch to J.D. Drew, brought in to pitch to him and make Chipper switch around and bat right-handed, but J.D. hitting 271 against lefties.
One and one, the count.
That's one of the reasons he is very successful against them, is that he's patient, doesn't lunge at left-handed pitchers, stays back and just wails on whatever they bring to him.
Two balls and a strike. Cleveland now 15-2 over the Reds in the eighth. Mike Timlin throws in the Red Sox bullpen. That's out of play. A fan from Dunwoody, Georgia, makes the play on the Lexus level. 2-2 the count.
Embry with a good fastball and slider.
Got him upstairs, up and in with a fastball, two down.
Good pitch by Embry. It was a ball, but this is a tough pitch to lay off of when you're trying to guard the plate. 2-2 the count. You see the fastball, but when it rides up and in on you, it's just almost impossible to stop your swing. Roche trying to find out a little something from J.D. in case he gets to hit off Embry.
Chipper Jones turns around, of course, to bat right-handed against his former teammate. And fouls it off, 0-1. Upstairs, 1-1.
Both of these teams have had bases loaded opportunities tonight and have not been able to cash in. Braves left them loaded when Chipper flied out in the fifth. Martinez, or Ramirez rather, just struck out. The bases loaded for the Sox.
Into right center field, the playable Trout Nixon grabs it. And Embry works a 1-2-3-8. Go to the ninth, all tied, 2-2. The voting went, and if the fans want it, the traditionalists are going to have to just suck it up, because if the fans want it, that's the way it should be.
I agree, and that's overwhelming.
And that's been the feeling, not just on our poll tonight, but every poll and focus group and what have you that baseball has employed. The fans overwhelmingly enjoy interleague play. Nomar Garciaparra leads off the ninth against John Smoltz, the fourth Atlanta pitcher of the night. And he blows it by him, 0-1.
Great slider to start him.
One and one the count.
We talked about the Red Sox defense at the outset of this ball game, but tonight it's been very good. And as a result, they're right in this one.
Trout Nixon is on deck on the 1-1 pitch. Low and away, two balls, one strike. Nearly 43,000 paid here tonight, and a bigger crowd expected tomorrow. Line drive, solid hit to start the ninth inning, and it looks like Garciaparra is fighting his way out of his slump. He's 3 out of 4 tonight. He was 7 out of 38 coming into this game.
John got frustrated. He threw a slider, made him look bad on it the first pitch, and then he didn't get the call with the slider on the pitch before. So rather than come back with something else, he decided to throw the fastball, and Garciaparra was all over. But I think that was John giving in a little bit after not getting a strike call on what was a very good slider before.
Trout Nixon is the batter. All the way to the screen, runner in scoring position. That'll be a wild pitch, and that's very unusual for Smoltz.
Might be his first one of the year. Second.
So the runner is in scoring position. You've got the lower end up there, but Boston's got some good hitters. Nixon, Veritek, and Pokey Reese in place of Bill Miller.
It's a wild pitch again. Almost hit Nixon in the foot.
Just missed inside. 2-0 the count. Smoltz wanted that pitch too. Young's heard it all before. He's a veteran umpire. The 2-0 pitch. There you go. No swing, they said.
Boy, that got everybody up out the Braves dugout.
Mark Wagner with a call, and he and Bobby Cox have at it from long distance.
Pat Corrales had his hat off. Bobby came up off the bench. Yeah, he did.
He went. But that's not the way the umpire saw it, and that's going to stand, and it's 3-0. So you got to forget about that and get back to business here. There's a strike. It's 3-1. Smoltz wants a new baseball. Jason Veritek waits on deck. Jay Hoover, our producer tonight, Gary Lehman, our director, with the good pictures on Friday Night Extra. Hope you're enjoying their good work.
John needs to make another pitch just like the last one. Try to fire something hard and away from Nixon. That's where they're setting up.
3-2. Pitch wound up inside.
Yeah. That might have been his A slider.
So Smoltz has battled back to a full count.
He threw a slider 3-1. He'll do it again.
Line foul. Hit hard.
Got away with one there. That one was just a spinner. May have even been a little bit of a backup slider. Just stayed right on the inside part. Actually a little bit off the plate, but Trot Nixon was all over it. Smoltz was lucky that he pulled it foul.
Was indeed a backup slider. You throw those, you're backing up third, backing up home.
Certainly are.
The 3-2 pitch. Got it. Smoltz battles back and gets Nixon.
3-2 split finger pitch. It just dives right at home plate. And Nixon goes over the top of it. Great pitch.
Bobby Cox out to talk about walking Veritek. They've got Pokey Reese and then a pinch hitter following him. We'll see what they do. Phillies are tied now with Baltimore 6-6 in the seventh inning of their game.
Veritek, pretty good numbers hitting with runners in scoring position, hitting .273.
He's one out of three tonight with a run scored and a fly ball down the left field line. Charles Thomas is there in foul territory, two out. And Pokey Reese is the batter.
Charles Thomas has got this left field line figured out pretty well. He plays just far enough off the line to be able to cover anything into foul territory, and that one was high enough for him to get under it. Second time he's done that tonight.
Reese, 4 out of 16 in his career against Smoltz. Upstairs. One ball, no strikes. Go ahead, run at second with two out. Houston has come from behind. They lead Texas 5-3. Foul tipped off the mask of Johnny Estrada.
Went right after him with a fastball. And from catcher cam, you see what Johnny Estrada felt.
A ball and a strike. Little low, 2-1. Garcia Parra with the go-ahead run at second. 2-2, the count.
He's had a very sharp slider, with the exception of one that was pulled foul. He's had a lightning fastball. He can take his choice right here, 2-2.
Full count, 3 balls, 2 strikes. Kevin Millar would be next. First base is open, so you certainly don't have to give in here.
No, sir, and that was a split finger pitch, and he missed with it. I'll be surprised if he comes back with a fastball. He threw Trot Nixon a 3-2 splitter and got the strikeout.
Another 3-2 pitch about to be made. And he walked in, and Millar will be the batter.
It was a fastball, and it was low. Too low.
Millar hitting 266. Two out of four as a pinch hitter with a homer and three RBI.
You're one of the infielders. You've got to try and knock anything down that's coming your way. Keep it from getting to the outfield, and that runner at second, make him stop at third.
Millar 2-for-8 against Smoltz. Strike 0-1. Fastball at the letter. This means a new pitcher is coming into the game for the Bo Sox. Ground ball foul. It's 0-2.
They had Keith Folt, their closer, up beginning of this inning.
Smoltz can do whatever he wants with him now. He's ahead 0-2.
These fans are as loud as they've been all year long last inning when Reitzma struck out Ramirez to end the inning. They're hoping for another strikeout here.
And there are a lot of Red Sox fans here, and that really makes it fun. It's sort of like a college football game. The 1-2 pitch. He's out of there, and the inning is over, and Millar argues with Larry Young. And if the other one wasn't a strike, that one certainly was. Maybe a break for Atlanta. One hit, no runs, no errors, two left, bottom of the ninth. Still tied.
By authority of the Office of the Commissioner of Baseball and may not be reproduced or retransmitted in any form. And the accounts and descriptions of this game may not be disseminated without express written consent.
Mike Timlin is 4-3, a 3.19 earned run average. This is his 38th appearance of the year for the Red Sox. He faces Johnny Estrada leading off the bottom of the ninth. Wasn't Timlin on the mound when Otis Nixon bunted to end that World Series?
He sure was. Teammate of Dave Winfield's on that ball club. He's in his 14th year, 38 years old. Toronto, Seattle, Baltimore, St. Louis, Philadelphia, and last year with the Red Sox.
Been a very serviceable pitcher throughout his long career. Estrada, Adam LaRoche, Andrew Jones due here in the ninth. One ball, no strikes. Alan Embry worked a perfect eighth, striking out one. Downstairs, 2-0. A walk would be a nice start.
Mm-hmm.
We're 2-2 in the ninth. Nobody has scored since the third.
Both starters did an outstanding job, but neither one will factor in the decision.
Base hit. Winning run is on there. Estrada singles, and now a decision for Bobby Cox. He can't run at all. Marrero has already been used. But they are going to go to the pinch runner, Jesse Garcia. So Eddie Perez, Atlanta's other catcher, will be employed if this game goes to extra inning.
Johnny getting high fives for getting the inning started, though, and it was a line shot.
Adam LaRoche stands in there. He is 1-for-3 on the night. Garcia, good base runner, edges away at first.
You would expect him to be bunting.
Adam wants to make sure, so he calls time and takes another look at Freddie Gonzalez. And that's a good idea. You want to be sure in this spot. position with one out. LaRoche does his job to perfection, a 2-3 sack.
Perfection is right, Skip. This was a beauty. Sinking fastball from Timlin, and he just deadened it right out in front of home plate. Got it to the grass, and that was a beauty. Nice job.
Andrew Jones, the batter. Andrew is 0 for 2 with a walk tonight. Hit into yet another double play, leads the major leagues in that department.
I did a pregame radio interview with him. Well, he's not going to get a chance to swing the bat here anyway. They're going to put him on. But he told me his goal in the second half was to be more selective, to not get himself in as many holes in the count, try to hit better pitches.
Andrew, 2 for 4 in his career against Timlin, which may factor in this decision. So young Charles Thomas will come to the plate with a chance to be the hero. Thomas has doubled and bounced out and been hit by a pitch.
And he's tough to double up. He's got good speed down the lines. He's been putting the ball in play. He'll put some pressure on this defense we talked about that have been a little porous. And if he can find a hole, maybe that'll score Jesse Garcia.
Julio Franco has grabbed a bat and moved on deck. He would pinch hit next for Smoltz if we get that far. Garcia carries the winning run at second. Red Sox played 13 innings last night. Fans on their feet here.
Just 2 strikeouts and 24 plate appearances for Thomas.
A lot of room in right center. Downstairs, 1 ball, no strikes.
Good stop by Veritek. That keeps him at first and second. But you got to figure that Francona wanted to set up the double play to help his infield, pitch around the veteran hitter, and put the pressure on a rookie.
The runner to third base where a fly ball can score.
Charles Thomas has already exhibited a zeal for this game at this level and a lot of fun, but he's also showed you a lot of ability. He's got a lot of confidence in his ability to play this game, and put it past him to knock in the winner right here.
Boy, had a good cut, but he fouled it back 2-1.
Right on.
Revs up a new baseball.
The outfield has to shorten up in case the ball is hit to the outfield. They've got to be in a position to throw out Garcia, so they're a lot shallower than they normally would be.
Broken bat, tap to first. The pitcher covers out there. Garcia rounds third, but stays where he is. It's all up to Julio.
I doubt he'll get an opportunity.
Well, I don't know. You got a faster man next for Carl. It does give you a force at every base.
Yeah.
Dave Wallace, the pitching coach. Much traveled pitching coach of the Red Sox on his way to the mound.
I look at it just from the standpoint of help for the defense, Skip. If Percal hits a ball in the hole somewhere, you've got to force at any base, and the infielders have that luxury. They don't have that luxury with runners at second and third if Julio were to do that.
Julio, the slightly bigger of the two men, so has a bigger strike zone than does Raquel on the other side of the coin. So we'll let the Red Sox decide what they want to do here. Timlin takes a little walk around the mound. Second and third, 2 out, but the only one that means anything is the runner at third. Mets 9-2 in the seventh over the Yankees at Shea. Tampa Bay 4-2 over the Marlins in the top of the ninth in Fort Lauderdale, or in Miami, rather.
We've already seen Timlin throw one ball in the dirt that was blocked by Veritek. Little pressure on the catcher, too.
He works off the stretch, and they will pitch to it. At least they won't intentionally walk it. One ball, no strikes.
93 on that fastball from Timlin. He's got a good number one tonight. The outfield playing Julio around the right, and they pitched him in.
The 1-0 pitch. Right in there. It's 1-1. And that too was a fastball, 93 miles an hour.
I think I'd have to try that inside again if I were the Red Sox. Just try to prevent a mistake on the outside part of the plate that Julio could rip the right, which is what he likes to do.
The 1-1. Front, low tapper to short. Garcia part of the first. And we got free baseball in Atlanta. We go to the 10th, all tied, 2-2. We go to the 10th inning. Eddie Perez on to catch. Sam McConnell, who picked up his first win here the other day. The left-hander on to pitch. It's a 2-2 ball game. The Red Sox 3-4 in extra inning games. The Braves are 4-3. We go to the 10th, top of the order up there for Boston, and here to tell you about it, Joe Simpson.
All right, Skip, thank you. McConnell 2 days ago worked 3 1/3 innings against the Marlins, gave up only one hit and gave up a run in his last inning of work. Walked three, struck out a batter, picked up his first major league win in that outing. Gets a little tip from Chipper Jones about Johnny Damon, who will lead off just in case Damon tries to push a bunt third base side. Damon's 0-for-4. He did reach on an error in the eighth inning. And the first pitch to him is down low, ball one. Tapped foul, count even. Damon has a 7-game hitting streak on the line. Julio Franco upset that he wasn't able to finish things in the ninth. Good breaking ball. Johnny Damon, born in Fort Riley, Kansas, but grew up in Florida, finished high school in the Orlando area. Slaps that one foul. Still 1-2. Spent most of his career with Kansas City. Part of a year with Oakland, became a free agent and signed with Boston. It's his second year with them. Curveball, lash to right field, base hit. Damon leads off the 10th with a solid single to right. He's hit an 8 straight. And he got a curveball. Almost looked like he was looking for it. And actually, it was one that stayed out over the plate. Gave him a chance to adjust. Mark Bellhorn will be trying to bunt him over, but takes it high. He's 1-for-4 tonight. But just 2 for his last 17. Damon 8 out of 12 in stolen bases, but the Red Sox are going by the book here, it looks like. And that's foul, 1-1. Boy, Bellhorn slides his right hand so far up the bat, he doesn't give himself much room at the end of the bat to bunt with. He has no sacrifice bunts this year. One pitch, he gets it down. Eddie Perez will have only one play. Nick Green covers it first. Bellhorn gets his first sacrifice of the year. And the Red Sox have the potential winning run in scoring position for David Ortiz. Ortiz has homered in four trips. That homer came in the first inning.
And he hit the daylights out of it. They say it went 407 feet, but I think it hit. Looks like it went a lot further than that.
Almost went to section 407. They're going to put him on and pitch to Ramirez. These two guys came up with an opportunity to put the Red Sox on top in the eighth inning. Bases loaded, one out. Chris Reitzma got Ortiz to pop up to shallow left field. That couldn't get a run in. And then Chris struck out Manny Ramirez on three pitches.
And Kevin Grabowski almost certainly will get the call against the right-hand hitter with a double play in effect.
You would think. There's ball four. Ortiz will trot to first. We'll keep an eye on the dugout. Here comes Bobby Cox. He likes Grabowski in these situations. Kevin gets a lot of ground ball outs. And that's what he's looking for here. And as Bobby Cox makes the pitching change, we'll send it to Mark Fine in our studios.
All right, thank you very much. Welcome back to TBS Sports Control.
The 12 walks in 26 innings versus just 7 strikeouts. And Ramirez was tied for the American League lead in homers by his teammate Ortiz, who hit that homer in the first. They both have 22 for the year. Sam McConnell will watch as Grabowski tries to take care of those two runners that belong to Sam. 1-0. Ramirez has grounded into 11 double plays this year. That's the most on the Red Sox team. Grabowski steps off. That's foul off his leg. Boy, the Marlins lost again tonight. That's 10 losses in their last 14 ball games.
They don't look real good.
Mm-mm.
But they get Josh Beckett back. They're going to start looking a whole lot better. Get Dontrell Willis straightened out.
They're certainly a better team than the way they're playing right now. Eddie Perez will go out and talk to Grabowski. They may have be having a hard time getting the signs to Kevin. Runner at second. So they're going through a series.
Florida needs one more bat in their lineup, too, don't they? I mean, one more good,
like,
solid hitter.
Like Derek Lee or Ivan Rodriguez?
Well, yeah, although Aesop Choi has done a good job at first base. He's not Derek Lee.
One and one to Ramirez. First and second, one out. We're in the 10th. Out of play. Got it in on his hands, one and two.
That fly ball to left field where the runner didn't try to score just looms larger and larger, mm-hmm. doesn't it?
I don't think David Ortiz was too happy about that either. He had a little bit of a scowl on his face as he came back to the Red Sox dugout that they didn't at least try to score that run. Up the middle, base hit. Andrew is over in right center. He'll have to hurry. Damon to the plate. He'll score easily. And the Red Sox take the lead, and Manny Ramirez comes through. It's 3-2, Boston. Andrew had too far to go to get in line to field that one.
And he got nothing at all on his throw. He tried to throw it so hard he threw it into the ground. That happens a lot. You got a fast runner going and no contest.
Ramirez didn't fail twice. Garcia Parra flied to center in the second inning. Since then, he's had three straight singles. And he got a vicious cut at a high fastball. If Grabowski's up there, he's in trouble. Damon's run belongs to Sam McConnell. Slider misses, 1-1. Johnny Damon looks like he just got called up from the House of David team.
Jeremiah Johnson. Mm-hmm.
Hard hit to third. Chipper with an in-between hop. Starts a double play. Can they get it? They can. Nicely done. 5-4-3 to get out of the inning, but the Red Sox take the lead. We go to the bottom of the 10th inning. Top of the order due up for the Braves. It's 3-2 Boston.
Who elected you leader?
Folk, who last year led the American League in saves with Oakland. He had 43. The Red Sox signed him as a free agent. And this year with Boston, Folk is 2-1, a 1.09 ERA in 35 games. He has 13 saves, 41 innings, 10 walks, 33 strikeouts, and just a 184 batting average against him. And he will face the top of the Braves order for Call, Green, and J.D. Drew. One other defensive change for the Red Sox, David McCarty takes over for the Red Sox at first base. Big Dave. Braves got a little bit of a look at Folk last year when he was with Oakland in interleague action. For Call, 0-for-1 against him. Tonight he is 1-for-4 in the ball game. 3-2 Red Sox. Call ran up as if he were going to slap one by Bellhorn, or try to anyway. 1-0. Strike. 1-1 the count. Manny Ramirez got the big hit in the 10th. Put the Red Sox on top. Changeup, slice down the line. Tough for play for Ramirez. He can't get it. It'll go to the corner for Call at second. He'll stop there. A leadoff double. And a tying run is in scoring position with nobody out.
He's such a good hitter when he does this. Hits the ball where it's pinned. Kept his hands back. Just slapped at it. Got himself a double.
Nick Green most certainly will try to bunt him over to third base. And set up an RBI opportunity to tie the game for J.D. Drew. Folk and Bellhorn talk over how they will attempt the defense of a possible bunt here. Garcia Parra trying to hold for Call close at second. Look out. I guess it missed him. It'll go to the screen and work as good as a bunt, but Nick Green lucky to get out of the way of that one. I thought it hit something, maybe just the catcher's glove as it went by.
Let's take another look and see what we can see. It was the catcher's glove. Boy, and he just about got hit right in the face on that baby.
Well, lucky to get out of the way. Braves have the tying run at third. 10th inning, the infield will come in. Folks' third wild pitch of the year. This would go a long way toward making Nick Green feel a little better about his night. 0-4, three strikeouts. The infield will try to cut off that run. Chase the bad ball. Good split finger pitch by Folk. That's his bread and butter. It's 1-2. Hard to do if you're a rookie, but Nick Green can't think about trying not to strike out again. He's got to try to put this in play. Almost hit again. 2-2. Third, nobody out. 3-2 Boston. That'll do it. Damon backs up a little bit, but he'll never throw out the call from there, and he knows it. We're tied again, and Keith Green comes through. His 19th RBI of the year.
They threw him a fastball, it looked like. I'm surprised by that. Did him a favor as it works out.
Well, the Braves have tied it. Now they'll try to win it. Only one out in the inning. J.D. Drew's homer tonight. 1-for-3 with a walk. He's never faced Folk before. 0-1. Must be on to JD in his first pitch drive, because that was a changeup to start him. 0-2. No runs had scored since the third inning, and now each team has scored one in the 10th. Just missed. 94 on that fastball, by far his best fastball so far here in the 10th inning. Inside, 2-2. Terry Francona with a little encouragement for Larry Young. Good cut, but he fouled it back. You can look at J.D. Drew's face as we just did a minute ago, and you never see any signs of any stress or pressing. Very calm. Got him with a changeup. Good pitch by Folk. Two out in the inning. And Chipper will be the batter. He homered in the second. 1-for-4 on the night.
That's a good pitch. Pulled the string on him, got it down low where he couldn't do much with it. It's what he wanted to do with Pacal, but got the pitch up.
Chipper bats left-handed. 1-for-3 in his career against Folk. There's a perfect strike on the outside corner. Third blown save of the year for the Boston closer. 1-1. Chipper's hit the ball hard tonight. Besides his home run, he's flat out deep to left. Hit the ball hard to right his last time up. Good cut, but he's behind in the count now, 1-2. The 1-2 pitch. Change up, got him. Chipper tried to stop his swing, it didn't matter. Folk comes back to fan Drew and Jones, but the double, the wild pitch, and the sacrifice fly tie it up again.
What do we? The third baseman Juan Cruz on to pitch for Atlanta. As we go to the 11th inning, and Trot Nixon will lead it off. He is 0 for 4 in the game, has struck out a couple of times, and the skinny right-hander deals outside. One ball, no strikes. 3-3 our score now in the 11th. High pop. Let's see if it stays in play. Eddie Perez.
I got it, watch it, I got it.
And made a great catch. One out. Eddie took it out of the front row. One away. Nixon 0 for 5.
Nice play. Right on the rail. And yelling that he had it right there at the end, and hopefully that, hoping that that fan would pull his hands back, and he did. Nice job.
Jason Veritek, the batter. A strike on the corner, 0-1. Red Sox have 10 hits, Braves have 7. Braves have committed the game's only error. Ground ball, just missed a double, may have broken his bat in the process. He did. 0-2, the count. Well, the good news is we haven't had any rain tonight.
Yeah.
Yet. Before driving home last night, I got about halfway, and it opened. You too?
Yeah.
Man, it rained.
Yeah, the Braves wouldn't mind a little sprinkle. They've been a pretty good rain team in this home stand.
John, I was kidding John Churros before the game. It's obvious we start our games too early.
Yeah.
We start 10, 11 o'clock. We're tough.
Uh-huh. Maybe they just turn the sprinklers on a little bit.
2-2, the count. One out, nobody aboard. That takes care of Veritek, and Pokey Reese, the batter. He's 0 for 2 against Cruz in his career.
Strikeouts becoming a pretty good part of Juan Cruz's arsenal. He is a team high 9.27 strikeouts per 9 innings coming into this outing tonight. 34 strikeouts in 33 innings.
To short. Tough play for Furcal, but he makes it. And the inning is over. We go to the bottom of the 11th. Time to win the game. It's and pops it up a mile high. Veritek in foul territory. Makes the catch. One pitch. One out. And Adam LaRoche, the batter. LaRoche has a hit tonight and a sacrifice. He's 1 for 3. One ball, no strikes. It was 2-2 from the third until the 10th, and the Red Sox pushed across a run. But the Braves did the same, and tied 3-3 in the 11th. Two balls, no strikes. Line drive, face it, right field. Winning run on, but with one out. And Andrew Jones, the batter.
Tried to run one in on him, and Adam LaRoche pretty quick inside. Knocked a little bit of rust off. Going on a rehab assignment to Louisville, or to Richmond. They played at Louisville, and he had a home run in one of those ball games, so he's swinging the bat good tonight.
Martinez out of the Dominican Republic. And a pop foul back by Andrew makes it 0-1.
Adam LaRoche does not run well. Doesn't eliminate any possibility of a hit and run, but with Andrew Jones up there, you're thinking more about a double and LaRoche scoring from first on a double, and their outfield's playing so deep right now, that might be hard to do.
Up and in. The Braves are flat out of position players, which is the risk you run with a 12-man pitching staff. That happens to you a lot. They still have good hitting pitchers, Russ Ortiz, Mike Hampton, available. He wouldn't have minded if that ball would have hit him. 2-1. Anastasio Martinez, a graduate of Santa Cruz College in the Dominican, signed by the Red Sox in 98, has been in their organization all this time. Good curveball there. 2-2.
Three straight breaking balls.
Two balls and two strikes. Did he go? No. 3-2. That was close as well.
Veritek spinning around in circles at home plate. He thought Larry Young rang him up, but what Larry was yelling was, did he go? Down to first base umpire Angel Hernandez.
Now let's see if they send the runner on the 3-2 pitch with one out.
Very risky here with LaRoche again not running well, and Andrew prone to strike out, but it would give him a head start if Andrew can find a gap.
Charles Thomas, the batter, Mark DeRosa hitting the ninth spot in the order, would be next. One ball, no strikes. They're underway in St. Louis, 1-1 after 2.5, after a lengthy rain delay. Two balls, no strike.
Charles Thomas would love to be the hero, but he's still got to be patient here, 2-0, and not overswing on something from Martinez that might be hittable. Put good wood on it.
The 2-0. A strike at the knees on the outside edge. Two balls, one strike. Anaheim, an early 5-1 lead over the Dodgers tonight. Pittsburgh winning a doubleheader from Milwaukee. 2-2, the count.
That's news. Milwaukee's been on a good roll. They've won 5 in a row until today.
They lost 8-1 in the first game. They're losing 9-2 late in the second.
Boston's got to be scratching their head wondering what it is they don't do right with the Mets beating the Yankees tonight 11-2.
Broken bat, grounder to short. Garcia Parra steps on the bag just in time. And the inning is over. We go to the 12th, tied 3-3.
What we mean, Coco Crisp going deep off Mike Matthews in the top of the fifth. Watch the fan in the green as Buddy interferes with him. Ball back on the field. Top of the eighth, Casey Blake at the plate. Same exact spot. This time the guy in the green lays off, says, you take it, buddy. He drops it, but then picks it up and gives it to his female friend. Big win for Cleveland in this one. Let's get you back to Braves and Red Sox.
Mark, I don't mean to correct you, but that Cleveland-Cincinnati game was played in Montreal. Just kidding. We're going to the 12th. Here's Joe.
And Dave McCarty will lead off for the Red Sox. He came in defensively in the 10th inning. Waves at one from Juan Cruz. Cardi hitting 225, couple of homers, nine driven in. Hit about 900 this spring. Falls behind 0-2. Hit 410 in spring training with seven homers and 18 RBIs. But he's on the bench right here. Three straight pitches from Cruz. Juan's got his second strikeout. We're in the 12th tie at three. Top of the order, Johnny Damon. Led off the 10th with his first hit of the night to extend his hitting streak to eight games. And eventually scored on a base hit by Manny Ramirez to put the Red Sox on top for a brief moment. Want to know? St. Louis and Seattle were delayed by rain for quite some time. They're in the third inning now. Cardinals up 3-1. 2-0 to Damon. Al Pedricchi, the new manager in Arizona. But he and the Diamondbacks taking it on the chin so far tonight. 5-0 Twins in the fourth.
Our director, Gary Lehman, just had a pretty good line. He said Johnny Damon was clean shaven when this game started.
Three and one.
CBS extra innings tonight.
Three and two. Mark Bellhorn on deck. Payoff pitch. Hit foul. Wow, is that ball caught? What a play. Fan went over the railing to try to protect some people in front of him. Look at that Whoa. Catch. Mercy.
That could smart a little bit if you're not careful.
Another 3-2. Walked him. First walk issued by Cruz. Fast runner board with one out for the switch hitting Bellhorn. There's one for four with a sacrifice bunt. Bellhorn had his best month so far this year. In June, we hit 287. Damon dives back safely. 8 out of 12 in stolen bases. Cruz falls behind Bellhorn 1-0. Bellhorn's got some pop in his bat. Nine home runs. Six left-handed, three right-handed. Way outside, 2-0, and Eddie Perez is going to try to rein in Juan Cruz. Oakland and the Giants go at it in their Bay Area battle. They're in the third inning, tied at three. Let's go. 2-0 pitch. Missed again, 3-0. With these rivalries that they've tried to maintain, what with the Mets and Yankees, A's and Giants, all the crosstown rivalries. I hope that they maintain the Braves and the Red Sox, something they didn't do last year. But it's fun when these two teams play. Three and oh the count. Let's see if Bellhorn has a green light. He's taking, and there's a strike, 3-1.
Braves need a good rivalry there, like they used to have with the Dodgers when both were in the Western Division. Of course, that didn't make any sense, the Braves being in the Western Division, but.
I think they've got a pretty good thing going with the Marlins right now.
Well, it's not really reflected at the box office.
Runner goes, throw down in time. Damon gunned down by Eddie Perez, or was it ball four?
Ball four.
It was ball four, never mind. Bellhorn started down the line, and then he stopped and turned around. Bobby Cox is trying to figure it out, too. Wow.
Pretty close. And obviously out at second, but doesn't matter because the runner had already walked, so he had to go to second base.
Pretty good pitch. Back-to-back walks put him at first and second. And Gabe Kapler's the batter. He came in defensively last inning. And a double switch, and now Eddie Perez out to talk to Cruz again. Kapler, former Texas Ranger, former Colorado Rocky. And hitting 261 with a homer and 10 runs driven in. Started his career with the Tigers. Slider misses, 1-0. Kapler didn't get to play much in the month of June, but he made the most of it when he did. He hit 351, 13 for 37. 1-1. $42,321 here tonight. We're in the 12th. Strike two. Two on, one out. Breaking ball, got him. Threw a breaking ball right at him and made him flinch a little bit. Strikeout number three for Cruz. And the batter is Manny Ramirez again.
There's nothing at all wrong with his stuff. It's just, we've said it before, location, location, location. When he can throw the ball where he wants to, he's very, very tough.
He'll need to do that with Ramirez, who singled in the 10th inning to put the Red Sox on top.
This game goes on, and they've got Ortiz out of the game, and the Braves have Chipper Jones out of the game. Mm-hmm.
Out of play. Manny tonight, 1-for-4 with a walk. His three outs were all strikeouts. The 0-1 to him. Chased a high fastball. Couldn't catch up. That was 96 miles an hour.
Yeah, he just blew it by him. That's what he's capable of doing.
Again, the Braves fans on their feet. Tried that same pitch that he used on Kapler, and it didn't work. Red Sox still have Doug Mirabelli on their bench. And I believe that's it. Braves have no position players left. Damon at second. Bellhorn at first. Slider got it. Juan Cruz strikes out the side. He walked a couple in between, but he leaves them stranded. We go to the bottom of the 12th. DeRosa for Colin Green due up. go to the bottom of the 12th inning, a tie ball game. Mark DeRosa will lead it off, his first at bat of the night. After coming in a double switch at the end of the 10th. Hitting 234. Look out. He almost got hit. Andrew Jones had to duck a couple of pitches. His at bat against Anastasio Martinez. Braves pitchers have struck out a season high 15 tonight. They've used 7 pitchers. Red Sox have used 5. Line right back through the box, base hit. Winning run at first to start the 12. Mark DeRosa, after going to the bench, didn't let that bother him too much. He hit 308 in the month of June and 52 at bats. Rafael Furcal, let's see if he's bunting. He squares around early, and the throw goes to first. Two hits on the night for Furcal, including a double his last time up, leading off the 10th. He eventually scored the tying run again that inning. Takes low. Nick Green delivered a sacrifice fly to bring him in. He's on deck. You saw right there, Baltimore and the Phillies are in the top of the 11th at Citizens Bank Park in Philadelphia. Call takes one strike there, 1-1. Mark Bellhorn right in on top of him. Paul pulled it back, was going to try to slap it past him, but takes outside. Has a very short lead at first base. Draws a throw anyway.
Okay, it's our time of night. Let's go. We've been playing at this time of night a lot this week.
Huh. Good point. Back easily. Martinez has thrown 20 pitches, 10 balls, 10 strikes. He's bunting, but tried to drag it down the first baseline and bunted it up into his body. 2-2. That was not a real good attempt by Furcal. See what he does now with 2 strikes on him. Line drive into center. DeRosa's going to take third. Furcal's going to try for second. He is safe. Second and third. Nobody out. Furcal took a huge chance there, but made it. And his base hit puts the Braves in business with nobody out.
So it's a good thing he didn't bunt as it works out. And you're right. If he has it to do over again, he probably stays at first base.
His run means nothing.
Right.
Nobody out. The Red Sox will be forced to walk Nick Green, you would think. But with J.D. Drew on deck, we'll wait and see. They may want to pitch to Green and then have the opportunity to walk Drew if they want. And that's what they're going to do. The infield in. Be alive for the squeeze. Nick Green delivered a sacrifice fly to tie the game in the bottom of the 10th.
Outfield and Little League depth, too.
He's 0 for 4, 3 strikeouts, and a sacrifice fly. The 0-1 pitch. Just missed inside, 1-1. Francona pointing out to Veritek to keep an eye on the runner. It's over. It may be out of here. Gone! Three-run jack for Nick Graves. Did he get the winning run in? He put a little icing on the cake and hit it in the seats. 6-3 the final, and check out the dugout. Braves have won 6 of their last 7. We'll be back to wrap it up right after this.
M for Atlanta, 6-11-1 with 8 left. For Boston, 3-10-0 with 10 left. Juan Cruz, the winner, 2-0. Anastasio Martinez, the loser, 0-1. Time of the game, 3 hours, 38 minutes, 42,321 paid to see it. 8th win in their last at-bat for Atlanta, and the first career walk-off homer for Nick Green.
Our next telecast is tomorrow on Turner South at 7 o'clock Eastern time as the Braves face the Red Sox in game 2 of this series. That'll be John Thompson against Curt Schilling. Our next telecast on TBS is Sunday at 1 o'clock Eastern for the final game of this series. That'll be Mike Hampton against Derek Lowe. And our next Friday night extra game will be August 13th against the St. Louis Cardinals. For Skip Carey and our entire TBS crew, glad you're with us. Hope you've enjoyed tonight's Friday night extra. Here's a look back at the first 8 Friday nights.
What is a strike these days? I don't know.
Made this ball out of here, TP. What's this? What are you stole you? What are you stole you?
What kind of, what hat is that? A Brewer hat.
Furcal's gonna try to come over anywhere.
Would you give up that hat for a ball?
You've been saying a lot.
Too much.
No.
Pitch out, throw to first. Got him.
Got him.
How about a bite of the hot dog for a ball? No.
Runner goes high and inside. He's in there.
How about the hat?
He's going. Got him.
Double play ball. We'll see. Green. Good turn. Got the double play.
Called fastball, and the long day's work is done.